Okay, we're here in Upper Montclair, about to watch Wheeler Ants Habanez's movie of the old Bootin' Line. Before we get into today's video, please make sure to like, subscribe, and always comment down below. It really, really helps out the videos. So, I'm very excited to see this because I've had many connections to the old Bootin' Line, which is the abandoned railroad that they're turning into the Essex Hudson Greenway. I've walked it many times, and now, you know, it's not going to be an abandoned railroad anymore, which sucks for me, you know. But he has a little show where he's going to be answering people's questions. He's going to narrate while showing his movie of it that I made. I've seen it on YouTube. You can check it out on YouTube for free. So it's here in the Silver Stream Studio in Upper Montclair. It's $5 to get in. Unfortunately, it's been sold out. He's doing 3 shows. Today's the 25th at 7:30 p.m. And yeah, like I said, I'm surprised that they've been sold out. As you head back here, it's very, very warm back here. But the studio is actually down here. You guys probably didn't even see it. We still have about another half an hour. The reason why I think it's sold out is because I think, you know, like really preppy people and well-to-do people are probably like, oh, I want to hear more about this new bike trail. Which is funny because in the words of Wheeler Ants Habanez, and he's also against the project, kind of like me, it's not really, it was already a greenway, you know, but they're actually putting gravel over it, which is not a greenway. So these people are, people think he's probably just going to be talking about the project itself. But I know Wheeler, I don't know him personally, but I know his content. He is an urban explorer and a writer for Weird New Jersey. So he's only going to be talking about the abandoned part. And I bet people are going to be disappointed to hear that, but I want to really get to meet him because I have, you know, a lot of the same interests he does. So right here, this little secret spot is where the show will be.
Worked out looking abandoned, decrepit thing. I really loved it that way. Now they fixed it up and they made it quite nice. And I believe somebody lives there. So they're going to have to get used to people walking by their house every day when it becomes a greenway. Flying backwards into Bloomfield and now flying forwards. And this is Broad Street. Now this bridge is pretty big. It's pretty sturdy. It's pretty from the top. They may have a challenge with. This is walking towards them right here. And every time I see one of these bags, I just can't help but check it out and see if there's anything in it. This is Spruce Street. Here's Belleville Avenue. You can see they're both 11-8 clearances. And then this is New Street, which is actually the first bridge we come to. That's an 11-6 clearance. As you can see from here, like as I'm balancing over this bridge, you can tell safe bridge is already used as a shortcut by people who live in this neighborhood all the time. And it's another bridge. Sometimes I've walked this far and I hang out here at the end of my walk and just watch the cars go underneath the bridge. This Garden State Parkway never ceases. It's always moving, even on like Christmas Eve in a snowstorm, it's moving. The only time it ever comes to a stop is during rush hour every day when it becomes a parking lot and you can't even drive on it because of all the traffic. I always look at this bridge and think of maybe like a stream or maybe a vascular system. And when they do have that parking lot style clot, it's sort of like a blood clot, you know? This is some old communications infrastructure. These rubber ones here are for the telegraph. These are for the telephone, the glass ones. They used to, along these lines, communicate by going beep, 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 you know, like Morse code. That's back in the 1800s. The graffiti war, where people come here and then, you know, other people cover them up, you know, and then people cover those people up. But over the years, there's been some really interesting stuff in this spot. I've had my eye on it. And of course, just going out for to go, and now it's being ripped up. So they're taking what was a greenway and turning it into a paved road from here. And we'll get into that later. So where do the deer go? Here's Franklin Avenue in Belleville. There's obviously no place for a deer there. And this was the one spot that they could really just be safe in this area. And now they have nowhere. JC9, 9 miles. This is right by Nanina's in the park, and it's also by this golf course here. And it's kind of like a castle or a fortress. It's very, very cool old bridge. I love it. I like to stand up here too and just kind of, you know, watch what goes on underneath. The graffiti starts to get pretty good around here, pretty thick. A lot of big names in New Jersey graffiti up in this spot. And here we come to, right on the border of Newark and Belleville, Biofoods. I'm not sure what they do here. It's kind of a big warehouse. But in the back, there's a very interesting graffiti chill spot, which is what we're seeing now. It's a little bit different than the other spot because when you paint here, you kind of expect to be painted over. So you might go there, do your painting, get a picture for Instagram, and then you come back the next weekend and somebody has already painted over you. That's how often it's changing here. And in addition to being a graffiti chill spot, it's also the last refuge for a very small herd of deer. Here's the patriarch of that herd. I've been seeing him, he's a big buck. I've been seeing him for years in this spot. He's got no place to go now that they're doing this greenway project. So where is he going to go? North Newark, which is what we're heading into right now. To the left, it's where they used to make all the silver, and they actually had a silver embossed paper that they sell there. And back in the 1800s, it was like $1 a sheet. That's how expensive it was. You can see that they've ripped off the roof here and they've made dormers on the top, and which is apartments. So they changed it into a residential building, and it was a really good reuse, kind of a win-win for everybody. Newark got to keep this really iconic tower, very beautiful building. So it's good to see it reused. People told me that this was not such a great neighborhood and they warned me about it. I really didn't think about it too much. Until I saw the stolen car go by. I heard it coming for blocks, and then he like got close to me and just lit up the tires, just smoked them out. So yeah, Newark's popping off a little bit, especially in the pandemic. This part of the Greenway has been blocked off all the way from the Tiffany & Company factory down to Broadway. I couldn't walk on it because it was completely taken over. So I took a slight detour to the right and walk down Verona Avenue, which is another street that people warn me about. And I would say, yes, there's some problems there, a lot of crack vials, heroin packets, broken needles on the ground. Right here at Broadway, this is where the old Booten line becomes elevated over the road. Here's Raff's Boat Yard, which is that building we just saw. I kept my boat there for 2 years and I just fell in love with this bridge. Just happened to be on this rail line that became important to me as well. A lot of people will recognize this bridge from Tony Soprano driving under it in the introduction to The Sopranos. So every time you watch The Sopranos, you see that bridge. This is the Kearny Cut. They call it the Cut Bridge because it emerges from this Kearny Cut. They also call it that because people use it to cut from Kearny into Newark. It's called a cut because it's blasted out of the solid rock of Kearny to create a level train bed from Kearny to the WR Draw. This ice that we're seeing here on both sides of the defile were actually underground streams that connected before they blasted out this thing. And every time it freezes, you can see where they used to connect, which is, I found very fascinating when I was there. This is under Kearny Avenue in the Kearny Cut, sort of heading out into Kearny. Chestnut Avenue, which is the last bridge or the first bridge, depending on which way you're headed. And from this shot, we can see Arlington Station, the Meadowlands, New York City, you know, I mean, beautiful, just gorgeous out there in the Meadowlands. And as you can see from this shot, I mean, it's some of the best walking in New Jersey. You can see why they want this for a greenway, because you can just walk so far. It takes so long to get out there. This is a New Jersey Turnpike. Booten Line goes right under that, out into the marsh. And in the distance, we can see Snake Hill and the New Jersey Turnpike Eastern Spur. This is an important spot for me because this is where the Newark Branch and the old Booten Line come together. So it's a nexus of two of my books and two of my movies. So I spent quite a bit of time out here exploring. To the left, we see the Atlantic White Cedar Stumps, which was a beautiful forest of Atlantic white cedar that human beings cut down because this wood doesn't rot. They did that in the 1600s, and these stumps are still here, not rotted. It never grew back. We destroyed the entire forest, and it's the shame that we can see at every low tide. This is where North Branch and the old Bootin line come together, leading up to the DB Draw. So this is the swing bridge over the Hackensack River at the base of Snake Hill. And it's a controversial, or at least questionable, bridge, because people are wondering, if you're going to make a greenway here, how are you going to get it across the Hackensack River with this bridge not working? It hasn't spun in 20 years since 2002 when these were abandoned. So it's very questionable how they're going to get it. Jutting rock coming out of the Meadowlands. Ace on the Don still riding high top Snake Hill, even though he's not with us anymore. It's very windy up there, and that's why they go through flags so quickly. Looking back on the DB Draw, we can see where we just came from, and here's where we're going. Now on Snake Hill, you can see they quarried all of this out, and they only left enough of the mountain just so it didn't mess with that highway right there. But most of it's gone in present day. And here's the bridge leading up to the Portal Bridge with an Amtrak train going across. And this is sort of the no man's land of Secaucus right here. It's another one of my favorite spots. I actually have a lot of favorite spots along this line. And where I come up to the sign that says end of track is actually the end of track for me. It's the end of the abandoned tracks. For them, it's the end of the live tracks. So we kind of switch, something out of The Simpsons, you know? The reason why it's like that, I assume, is because it's at the base of the Hudson Generating Station, which has now been demolished. People in Jersey City might remember when it was demolished because nobody told them that they were gonna do it, and they did it at 6 a.m. It shocked people literally out of their beds with this huge explosion. So yeah, they left a legacy of pollution out there that's pretty bad. Pretty beautiful. I mean, here, this is the garbage burner in Newark right here. I mean, you wouldn't expect a garbage burner to look so beautiful, but it did. So the next morning, I started again. I wanted to get to this cemetery here, which is St. Peter's Cemetery. That's where I was trying to get to when I was going to duck under that freight train. It's kind of a link between the Bergen Arches and the old Bootin line. I thought that the tracks originally went in this right there, but I was completely wrong. It's actually, they took a totally different way to get into the Bergen Arches. But you can't tell any of that stuff anymore because the infrastructure has been completely rebuilt, completely changed. So, that they had, this arch right here fell and killed 11 people in one shot. Above it, we have the DL and W tunnels, which is the present day Hoboken line. That's the Hoboken train coming out of Hoboken. But we're more interested in the abandoned. So we're gonna head into the Erie Cut, the Bergen Arches. This right here is the western portal of the Bergen Arches. As you can see, it's very cold down there. There's icicles hanging. And that's a bad thing because water has permeated these arches. When it gets into the concrete, it expands when it freezes and it breaks the concrete apart. Now, it's holding up the entire infrastructure of Jersey City, so that's probably something to worry about. I think there's a lot of attention that needs to be paid down here. One of the interesting things about this Erie Cut was flying my drone here. Usually you think about flying a drone really high. I got to fly my drone literally through the bowels of Jersey City, you know, underground drone flying. It was kind of interesting and a lot of fun. But as you can see kind of from this shot is that there's only one way in and there's one way out. So it could be a dangerous place for a greenway because you could easily get mugged in there and no cop could save you. This phone was thrown down from the top off of one of the bridges. And of course I had to bring it home with me. It's now hanging on my wall in my shop. If you are to go down there, I would definitely suggest wearing a helmet with a light on it. You can start out walking through these tunnels. And then you get to the middle and you can't even see your hand anymore because it gets so dark. That's one thing I found out. Definitely wear a helmet, definitely bring a light. So these tunnel systems come out underneath Dickinson High School and they basically emerge into this art gallery of graffiti. absolutely amazing graffiti down here, and it's always changed. This was my spot, and I don't want to share it. I also like the rails the way they were. I would have preferred them to not be ripped up. But since the rails have been ripped up, I would say that if we could just not pave this thing, if we could leave it just the way it is, basically, and make a path that could be good for bicycles, that could be good for people, that could be good for animals, something not paved, then yeah, I'm totally for it. I think it's a great idea. I think it's a fantastic idea. It's going to be the best walking in New Jersey. It's going to be incredible. But to take something that already was a greenway, pave it, and then try to sell it back to us as a greenway, that I cannot stomach, because it's PR, it's a lie, you know. So I will say this, I'm not opposed to the greenway, I'm only opposed to paving it. That's it. And I think that if we were to make this greenway and not pave it, we could take that extra money and we could use it to fix the bridges along the way. And then we wouldn't be so in the red. So that's basically where I stand on that.
Yes, I'm curious about
WFMU. He was telling me, dude, you gotta go out, you gotta go into the marsh, you gotta keep walking. So then I walked out in, you know, on this old Booten line, and I realized that the tracks I'm walking in Montclair, the tracks I'm, you know, looking at in Kearney, and the tracks that X-Ray told me to walk on in Kearney, they're all the same, you know? And then I started reading newspapers that they were gonna turn it into the Greenway. So I was like, you know what? I better just walk this whole thing. So I walked it in 2020, and I made a just a piece on my website. Like I said, I'm not really a train guy, so it's not really a big deal. I think it's fine that they ripped all that stuff up, and if they wanted to make a trail out of it right now and just leave it basically the way it is, but kind of pack it down so people can ride bikes on it and stuff. Because that Caldwell right now, they use that as a running trail, a biking trail, and it's not paved, and it's great. People use it all day long. I have absolutely no objection to that whatsoever. But what I think we lose is a habitat for the animals that have almost no habitat left. I mean, you wouldn't really expect to see deer in Newark, you know? I wouldn't, anyway. I wouldn't even expect to see deer in Montclair, but we do have them here, you know? And the only place they really have is that line. And I know that human beings, our policy is basically just like, who cares about that, you know? But when I go out there and I see the look in that deer's eyes, man, it breaks my heart, you know? What I lose personally is like my awesome abandoned railroad tracks that I don't want to share with anybody, you know? Because I used to go out there on that walk, man, I wouldn't see anybody. Mm. You know, I'd go out in the Meadowlands, I'd be all alone that day, especially in the wintertime. In the summer, sometimes you'd see people. But man, in the middle of winter, it was a really great place to social distance during COVID. That was actually one of the things that really got me out there. Mm. Well, the deer really, like, you know, just the fact that there's deer around in Newark, I thought that was really odd. I also saw a really mangy fox, which I actually wasn't sure if it was a coyote or a fox. It was so mangy in Newark. I'm trying to think of anything really weird that I saw. On my other walk on the Newark branch, and I don't know if any of you are familiar with this, but I came across this giant cat, and it turned out to be a float from the Macy's Day Parade. That was very odd, and it ended up being really weird on this scheme, basically. Again, though, I'm not opposed to it. I think this is an excellent walkway, but I just think they've approached it a little bit overzealously, maybe is a nice way to put it. So again, my suggestion, and who am I? Nobody, I'm just some guy who walks on the tracks. But my suggestion is, like, let's not pave it, let's fix the bridges as best we can, and let's just leave it a natural greenway so the animals can stay there. And then—
All right, so that went really well. It was actually amazing meeting Wheeler and Tavanez. Come to find out that's not actually his real name. I'm not gonna say his real name because he's trespassed and explored so many abandoned places that he technically can't go to. I'm not, you know, gonna reveal his real name, but it actually came to, that name came to him in a dream, and it's the total opposite of his real name, which I was like, Wheeler Antabanez, like, is that Spanish or what? I don't know. But anyways, it was good meeting him. I guess because he was, you know, kind of busy trying to set everything away. You know, I asked if I could do like a, you know, like a 2-minute quick interview or stuff. He didn't really want to, but he was a pretty nice guy. I can understand. He asked if I wanted a picture. I was like, no to the picture, because I suck when it comes to pictures, bro. Every picture of me is bad. You know, I explained to him that I have an interest for exploring abandoned stuff. You know, I've been to the Gates of Hell in Clifton, which is the most dangerous place to explore around here. The abandoned tunnels. They're not abandoned. They're just sewer tunnels. But, yeah, I've been back there. And he knows one guy that was, I think he was doing work in those tunnels. And, you know, just a bunch of water came and drowned him. Which, now kind of makes me not want to go to, the Gates of Hell anymore. It is totally scary. My first, you know, explorations of places started off in Clinton Road in West Milford. That's more haunted, but, I mean, abandoned and haunted are kind of the same thing, but there's not really any legends on the old Booten line or in any of the abandoned factories in, Newark or, you know, out in the Kearney Marsh. But, you know, it's just, his stories are amazing. And, you know, I was really surprised to see the type of people that were there. At first, you know, before I went there, I thought it'd just be a bunch of preppy people from Montclair. And, you know, being from Montclair, I actually don't have a problem trash-talking my town, which is not good. But, just over the years, I've realized Montclair's not really the town for me. Like, I don't want to become somebody in finance or be, like, a lawyer. Like, I'd much rather be doing, like, a blue-collar job. I'm into exploring abandoned places, for Christ's sake. I spend, you know, a lot of my free time in Newark, you know. Like, Montclair's not really the town for me. Anyways. You know, I just find it interesting because there's no, really no kids my age that are into exploring abandoned places like I am. But, you know, I just explained a lot of my stories to him in like 5 minutes and, you know, while he was just packing up and getting ready to go. So he actually did check out one of my live streams. I had no idea of walking the old Booten line, but yeah, super interesting, you know, all his stories. He's told me that he's ran into some crazy confrontations on the old Booten line. One time he said one of the persons that owned a truck lot in the area was very upset with him, and then, you know, he explained his story because he, and then they wound up shaking hands. And but that's not even the craziest. I don't even want to know what the craziest things were, but I haven't ran into too many crazy confrontations on the old Booten line myself. I don't run into too many confrontations. I guess I'm lucky. He also, you know, talked to me about, well, he doesn't do graffiti tags anymore, but one of the highlights of the old Booten line is all the graffiti tags. There's so many of them. Not even tags, just art. Beautiful, like, mural, like, almost like mural-level graffiti. And you have big graffiti artists like Adopt Six. Adopt Six is actually the one who went on top of a swing, like a drawbridge that's just been open, the Annie Bridge in Newark. He climbed to the top of this riggedy open drawbridge. Like, you know how a drawbridge goes up? It's standing up and it's been in that position for decades. And he actually went to the top and tagged his name on it, which is incredible. That's not something I would do. I'm not going to say I haven't done tags, because I have, but of graffiti, but, you know, I really shouldn't have just said that, because now, hope no authorities are watching my video. You know what, though? Graffiti tags, most graffiti artists don't wind up going to jail, because there's so many other, you know, bigger crimes in our country than graffiti. It's a lot of crime in America, so the cops aren't too concerned about graffiti tags, although you should be really careful. That's going to be for today's video. I hope you guys enjoyed. Please make sure to like, subscribe, and God bless to all you guys.